Hello, I'm Alan Denton from Physics Partners, and in this short film, we're going to look at how to teach nuclear fusion and nuclear fission. This film is part of a series to help with your physics teaching, especially if you are new to teaching, new to physics, or just looking for some new ideas. I'll focus on the common misconceptions that students have and give you some tips for introducing this concept, especially if you are teaching remotely. Feel free to pause and take notes or rewind and watch again. Before I ever start teaching about nuclear fission and nuclear fusion, it's really important that students understand about atomic structure. So, if you were to give some students a bunch of bottle tops like this, how would you expect them to model carbon-12? So what features have we got here? We've got the nucleus, and in the nucleus there are 12 particles, but these are actually made up of 6 neutrons and 6 protons. Carbon has got 6 protons in it, so actually we could write it as 12C6. And this number at the top, 12, tells us the nuclear number, which is the number of neutrons plus protons. And then, of course, we've got 6 electrons whizzing around the outside. I really like modelling with bottle tops because I can clearly see what the students are doing. You can use other things, for example, poker chips, pennies, tiddlywinks. Any kind of coins or cut-out bits of card can work. So some potential areas for confusion with students could be, is fission and fusion the same thing? And are atoms destroyed in fission and fusion? So how can we get energy from a nuclear process? Well, we probably need to start by talking about two things that we've told students before. So the first is that energy is conserved. And we've hopefully drummed that into them, you know, at the start and at the end, the total amount of energy is always the same. Similarly, in a chemistry lesson, they'll have learnt mass is conserved. Now, this is also true in terms of a chemical equation, but we now need to let them know the full picture. And the full picture is an equation that we don't need to teach them, but we probably, most of them will have heard of anyway. And that equation is E equals mc squared. And it relates to this because the energy measured in joules can be equivalent to a mass measured in kilograms. And we can't do it in a normal process, but we can in a nuclear furnace, for example, in a nuclear power station or inside the sun, we can convert energy into mass or mass back into energy. And how does this work? Well, that's where this C comes in. This C, bizarrely enough, is the speed of light, or part of Einstein's genius that he saw this relationship. And the speed of light is 300 million meters per second. So what does that mean? How can we convert? Well, as I say, we can't do it easily, but in a nuclear power station, we can convert some mass into energy. Well, what would happen if we converted 1 kilogram of mass into energy? 1 kilogram times the speed of light squared. So that's times 3 × 10⁸ squared. And the answer to that is 9 followed by 16 zeros. So let's write that out. That is 90,000 trillion joules of energy. So converting 1 kilogram of mass into energy gives us 90,000 trillion joules of energy. I think it's a real challenge for students to get their heads around the fact that mass becomes energy in a nuclear process. So the way that I model it is by physically demonstrating that with some plasticine models. So I have 4 particles, each should be about 20 grams. So they are 2 neutrons and 2 protons. And if I squish them together, I can get them to form a helium nucleus. Now, everyone should assume that 4 lots of 20 will be 80 grams. But if I put that on, we should be able to see we get something slightly less. And the difference between the 80 that we were expecting and the 78.2 that we got is called the mass loss. So here we've got a mass loss of 1.8 gram. And in a similar way, we can model nuclear fission. So if we have a uranium nucleus, which could be, for example, inside a nuclear reactor, and we hit it with a slow-moving neutron, we'd expect a certain mass, in this case 70.4 in my model. But the products that it breaks into, and it's not always the same products, but the products that it breaks into have got a slightly lower mass. So again, we have got a mass loss, and that mass can become energy. So we can compare nuclear fission with nuclear fusion. Nuclear fission is what happens in a nuclear reactor. So for example, a large uranium nucleus absorbs a slow-moving neutron and breaks apart to form smaller fragments. There is a mass loss, only a small mass loss, but there is a mass loss, and it's that mass loss that releases the energy. In the sun, we've got a nuclear fusion process, which is where smaller particles are combined together, but again, there is a mass loss, which means it gives off energy. Proportionally speaking, fusion normally gives off a bigger percentage mass loss than nuclear fission. So actually, if in the future we can get nuclear fusion reactors working, and there are lots of technical hurdles for that, then nuclear fusion should be a better source of energy for us than nuclear fission. I like to model nuclear fission using a cake with bits in. For example, I've got a cherry cake here with some cherries representing neutrons. Now, if a neutron comes along and it gets absorbed by one of the uranium nuclei, it will break up into two fragments. And it will also then give off between two and three, further neutrons. So those further neutrons will come along, and if they then get absorbed by other uranium nuclei, well, we've got a chain reaction going on. And you can quickly see that you go from one neutron to 3 to 9 to 27, 81, 243, and if it's only taking a billionth of a second to go like this each step of the way, you'll have a nuclear bomb, because each single time one of these breaks apart, there is also a small mass loss. That mass loss releases energy. So if you go rapidly through this, you will release an enormous amount of energy. So we don't want this if we're building a power station. We want to slow it down. So there are various things in terms of the design of a power station that slow it down. There will be something around the atoms that's absorbing some of the neutrons, but you also have a control rod that can be inserted into the nuclear reactor, which is specifically designed to absorb some of the neutrons. So a boron control rod can be inserted, and if you've got it so that it absorbs on average enough neutrons so that there's only one neutron going through for every one that then goes on to create another one, that will be a continuing chain reaction, but it will be a stable reaction. So we can compare nuclear fission and nuclear fusion. In nuclear fission, nuclei split apart into smaller ones, and when big atoms are doing that, they're actually going to lose mass and give off energy. And nuclear power stations use fission. Fusion is used in the sun. It is when nuclei combine together to form bigger ones. If you are fusing together small atoms, there can be a mass loss, and that can give out. So we've looked at ways that we can help students to visualize the nuclear process and to see how an extraordinary amount of energy can be released from this mass loss. I hope that's been a help in teaching this topic. Hope to see you again soon.